Ladies and gentlemen, PV Memorial Lecture by Honorable President of India, Shri Pranab Mukherjee Garu.
Shri ESI
Narasimha, Governor, Andhra Pradesh. Dr. K. Rosaya, Governor, Tamil Nadu. Kiran Kumar Reddy, Chief Minister, Andhra Pradesh. Dr. K. Ramchandra Murthy, Managing Director, The Hands India. Bani Devi, daughter of P.V. Narasimha Rao. P.V. Rangarao, his son. P.V. Rajeshwar Rao, his son. P.V. Prabhakar Rao, his son. Ms. Anita Saluja, resident editor, Hands India. Distinguished guests, ministers, former ministers, ladies and gentlemen. At the very outset, let me pay my respectful personal tribute to this great son of India and congratulate Hands India and Hyderabad Media House for organizing this memorial lecture. As per the practice, normally the memorial lectures are written texts because it is preserved by the organizers. Therefore, I have penned down my ideas about the perception I have about P.V. Narasimha Rao and my evaluation about him as contributor to India's progress and development. Therefore, I would like to place it on record and I will hand over the copy to the organizers. And based on my what I have written, I would like to share, somewhere expanding, somewhere avoiding, which are not necessary, and confine my observations. I came to know P.V. Narasimha Rao in the 70s, when I was a junior minister in the government of Mrs. Indira Gandhi. I came to work in close cooperation with him at a very critical moment of the Indian National Congress, after the defeat of Mrs. Indira Gandhi and Congress Party in 1977. In fact, what is geographically called as Aryavarta, that means on the north of Bindhos, the Indian National Congress was completely wiped out. If I remember correctly, we did not get any seat in Bihar, in UP, in Haryana, in Punjab. We got only one seat in Rajasthan, only one seat in Madhya Pradesh. Then there was no Uttarakhand, no Jharkhand, no Chhattisgarh. Only three seats in West Bengal. Assam and Northeast we did well. Even in Maharashtra, we did not get majority. Out of 48, we just got 24. Later on, P.V. jokingly used to tell me, Pranav, the wind was held up by mighty Bindhos. That's why in South, performance of Congress was wonderful. If I remember correctly, in whole of Andhra Pradesh, Congress lost only one seat. Whole of Tamil Nadu, Congress lost only one seat. Whole of Karnataka, Congress lost only one seat. Kerala performance was not very good. And out of 153 seats which Congress got in 1977 election, majority came from South. And the context in which I came in close contact with P.V. Narasimha Rao, he was one of the very few of the senior leaders who stood by Mrs. Indira Gandhi at that moment of crisis. I was a junior man. I was a junior minister. I am talking of the 70s. Therefore, and thereafter, till he breathed his last, I had the privilege of working with him in various capacities, in Congress Working Committee, in Union Government of led by Mrs. Indira Gandhi, in his government. I had the privilege of working with him as Deputy Chairman Planning Commission, as Commerce Minister, as Foreign Minister. So I had the opportunity of knowing him closely. The first thing which struck me is his political sagacity and capacity, brilliant capacity of having very comprehensive idea of most complex problems and also how to resolve such problems. All of us are fully aware of, he was the father of Indian economic reforms, second generation reforms. But the political sagacity and farsightedness which he displayed at the formation of the government, please remember, when he formed the government in 1991, in the general election of 1991, Congress got only less than 226 seats. Punjab election took place after some time, and in Punjab, out of 13 seats, we got the majority seats. The strength of the Congress was 232. Well short of 275, which is required for the majority. At that time, the responsibilities of running the Congress and running the government as Congress President and as Prime Minister fell on him. He had his idea about the economic reforms. It is not that out of blue this idea came to him, because when we are drafting the 91 election manifesto, if you go through it, you will find that there is his prints and indications of the economic reforms. And since my memory goes, no Congress document was finalized unless it was vetted by P.V. Narasimha Rao, because he was known to be a great draftsman and mastery of our language. Therefore, not many I used to draft the manifesto, preliminary drafting, and finally it was vetted by him. In 1991 election manifesto, the indications were quite clear. But the marvelous selection of Dr. Manmohan Singh, not a traditional political activist, as finance minister at that crucial time, speaks of the political sagacity of the man. and after 1950s when Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru selected C.D. Deshmukh, the then Governor of Reserve Bank of India, as the Finance Minister, no other apolitical persons have been appointed as the Finance Minister of the country till that point of time. Always there were political heavyweights who were chosen as the Finance Minister, but he recognized that it would not be an easy task for a normal political activist to implement the far-reaching economic reforms. And the depth of the economic crisis today we have forgotten, because we are sitting at the high table at the global level, considered one of the G20 countries which account for 85% of the world output. It was not possible to imagine today what economic situation prevailed in 1991. Foreign exchange reserve came to just $1 billion, worth of 2 weeks' imports. Budget could not be passed in the Lok Sabha. Vote on accounts were taken for a few months by the outgoing government. Indian electorate did not give a very clear verdict in favor of P.V. Narasimha Rao. It was in his own language. He used to say, yes, it is a mandate, but the mandate with a limitation. Indian electorate tell me that we have given you the mandate to rule but carry people with you. Therefore, he had to build up consensus. But where he found it is necessary at the larger interest of the nation and the country to do what is proper and just, he did not hesitate. It was not possible for an ordinary political leader to take a bold decision like this. He did it. And the country is getting a benefit today. I am not going to discuss in details of the economic reform measures which he have introduced in my text. I have discussed in details. The second point on which I will give him the credit for giving a new turn to the India's foreign policy. ASEANs were created in the 70s, but we did never, in our foreign policy parameters, gave any importance to build up close relationships with ASEANs. Yes, individually the countries had good relations with us, those countries which constituted the ASEANs. Whether it is Singapore, whether it is Korea, whether it is Philippines, whether it is Indonesia, bilaterally we had excellent relations with all of them. But ASEAN as a group, we did not recognize the potentiality of it at that point of time. His contribution to Indian foreign policy, which he termed as the Lukist policy, in the context of the economic reforms, has paid us rich dividend today. The ASEANs has emerged as the largest trading partner of India in the international trade. And that is substantially contributed by P.V. Narasimha Rao as the architect of Lukist policy. The importance and emphasis which he gave on connectivity, the importance he gave in strengthening the relationship with ASEAN as an unity, ASEAN as an unit, ASEAN as an entity, can be clearly understood that first there was a ASEAN by that time had developed an idea which was not very cordial, because long time they waited for India. Therefore, first we had sectoral dialogue partner in the diplomatic language. That began in 91. 96 it became full dialogue partner. And after 96, today, we are sitting with them in summit. 20th December this year, the summit took place in Delhi, where 10 head of the government and states of belonging to ASEAN came to India. Our relationship has converged from sectoral dialogue partnership to summit level partnership. Initiative was taken by P.V. Narasimha Rao, and it has strengthened our look east policy. These are the emerging economic powerhouses. The third area on his political sagacity and administrative competence is the resolution of terrorist problem in Punjab. As a minister, I was deeply involved from the 80s. Along with P.V. Narasimha Rao and Venkat Raman. He was then Defense Minister of Indira Gandhi. P.V. was Foreign Minister of Indira Gandhi. I am not going into details because I have details, some of these aspects in my written text. How the vexatious problem of Tamils in Sri Lanka, he settled as Foreign Minister during the Jayavardhana's time. Because of the paucity of time, I am just going to, I will not take more time of you, I will conclude, because most of the things I have written in my written text and which will be given to the organizers. 85 onwards, after the Rajiv Longowal Pact, and after assassination of Longowal, first election took place, Akali Party came to power, but terrorism increased. Punjab became really burning. Not doubts. 1991, after P.V. Narasimha Rao took over, it was possible for him. 91 Lok Sabha election did not take place. 89, no election could take place in Punjab. Constitution had to amend several times to extend the president's rule under Article 356 of the Constitution so that a government can continue. Several times Indian Constitution had to amend. If you go through the schedule of the amendment of the Constitution, you will find it was done only to facilitate the period of presidential rule under Article 356 from 1 year to more than 1 year, several times, because there was no atmosphere of holding election. He brought peace in Punjab, held election. Bhian Singh was chosen as the Congress Chief Minister, Congress got the majority, and Punjab is now peacefully administered. Many people have spoken about the contribution of P.V. Narasimha Rao in science and technology. This was one of his passion. He used to rather rebuke me because I am very bad in computer, and he was quite excellent in computer. So sometimes when I used to go with him with the written draft or written text, he used to tell me, no, I don't want to see it. You just send me the computer disk. No, I don't know, I don't use. And he used to, because he had a savvy for him. He liked it. And today we are getting the benefit of it. Therefore, and as Congress President in Tirupati itself, in his very first session. After many years, he introduced the election in the Congress Working Committee. Many of us suggested to him that why don't you take the responsibility? ICC is ready to pass a resolution that you should nominate the members of the Working Committee. He said no. Let the members choose. And 10 members were elected to Congress Working Committee after many years. Therefore, this man has multifaceted capacity, and his contribution, starting at a very young age, he was one of the youngest delegation in Tirupati session of Congress. I do not remember either Tripuri or Horipuri, because he told me he voted for Subhash Chandra Bose. And when Subhash Chandra Bose had to contest with Pottabhisita Ramaiah in that Congress, he was one of the youngest delegation. Therefore, this man, since his days of participation in the freedom struggle, inspired by Mahatma Gandhi, Jawaharlal Nehru, and Swami Ramanand Tirth, once he told me these are the three great personalities who molded his visions, his ideas, his literacy activities, his command of our languages. 16 languages he had mastery over. He was proficient equally in Marathi, in Telugu. Therefore, if Hanumkonda refused to elect him, Ramtek of Maharashtra would not refuse to elect him. They will elect him, because they did not find any difficulty of communicating with him. Being the first Southern Prime Minister in India, Devegowda came later. He was the first Southern Prime Minister. He had no difficulty in communicating with the Hindi-speaking North India, because his mastery of our language. In P.V. Narasimha Rao, we have not only a multifaceted personality, but he was a great leader, a great Prime Minister, and history will remember him of providing leadership to this nation, millions of this country, at a very critical juncture. Once again, I express my deep appreciation for Hans India, Hyderabad Media House, for organizing this memorial lecture. And my request would be, it should be the annual event, and our efforts should not be ended in one exercise. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for the patience. No, I